Welcome to my channel SK Knowledge. Today we know what is the formation of our own solar system. When we look around our solar system, we got to remember there's a few characteristics that we want to keep in mind. For starters, everything orbits the sun in the same direction. That is, if we are looking at the solar system from, let's just say, overhead, everything would appear to be orbiting the sun in a counterclockwise rotation, but there are some exceptions to this rule, and that is comets. Sometimes the occasional comets will look to come in a clockwise direction as seen from overhead. Otherwise, here everything orbits the sun in the same direction. Another thing to think about is that if you look at the planets, they are arranged from sun out to, say, the orbit of Neptune. It turns out that these planets all seem to orbit the sun in roughly the same plane. That is essentially what we know thing to of is ecliptic. But beyond Neptune, you see there's an abundance of highly inclined objects. These are dwarf planets, the Kuiper Belt objects, and so forth. They seem to be a bit tilted above and below the plane of ecliptic. So if we are going to put together a model of how solar system formed, it's important that whatever we consider has reproduced what we currently see today. Astronomers have a pretty good hypothesis as to how our solar system formed. We believe that our solar system formed within a cloud like you see here. There was once upon a time a rotating disk, and as this disk was coalescing and around the protosun, which is deficit at the center, there are little instabilities within the disk. The disk fragmented, the clumps and disks are fairly common. You can make out the distinctive rings and spoke like the features of the disks. So this is significant because it means that there are protoplanets inside the protoplanetary disks that are beginning to sweep out the concentration of gas and dust within their orbits. So as we gaze around the solar system, we found there's a variety of objects, namely giant planets and terrestrial planets. Giant planets are composed of most light weight materials, what we call volatiles. For example, this is dry ice, frozen carbon dioxide, and frozen ammonia. So are we gonna have these very light weight materials such as hydrogen, helium, methane, chlorofluorocarbons, all cold enough to become an ice. And it's for this reason that these planets have relatively low density. But terrestrial planets, on the other hand, have relatively few these lightweight elements. They are mostly composed of rocky refractory materials, some minerals, olefin, and so forth. Why then are these two types of planets so very different from one another in terms of their composition? The answer goes back to the formation of planets themselves. Remember, it all formed inside of the disks that you see here. So if we think that these deficits of our proto solar system, we have an abundance of refractory material starting from just around the protosun all the way of very edges. There's plenty of silicates, plenty of carbonates and minerals, and so forth. However, it is not until you get past, say, the orbit of Mars towards the orbit of Jupiter, temperature drop low enough that protons can condense water molecules, hydrogen, and so on. In the other parts, they freeze out. They become solid enough, or at least slushy enough, in order to fully condense. In fact, once you get out past the orbit of Saturn and the temperature are low enough to even allow the high volatiles such as hydrocarbons, methane, ammonia, so forth, they can even start to condense. So the point where the temperature drop low enough is called frost line. It's really just a distance where the temperature are low enough to for volatiles to condense. Why then are the small rocket airships closer to the sun and the larger gas ice giants farther for the sun? It's because of the temperature difference. It's only in the outer solar system where these large planets can form, because they have abundance of both refractory and volatiles. However, they inside the solar system where the terrestrial planets live, there are only refractory materials to build with. So how does a spinning gas disks of gas and dust go on to become planets? Well, in order for us to think about that, we have to change our perspective. We have to go deep inside the circumstellar disks, and instead of thinking about the disks as a whole, we need to change our scale and get smaller until we are finally at the scale of individual grains of dust. These dust particles will go on to become planets. Here's how they do it. First of all, dust particles are not same exact kind of dust particles that we think in our rooms and in our houses. Dust in space is mostly composed of silicates and crudites, whereas the dust is in our rooms are composed of dead skin cells, insect pieces, and so forth. Well, since there are no people or insects in the space, why we are left with a slightly different kind of dust. Nevertheless, these fine dust particles do carry an electric charges, just as particle of dust that and dirt carry electric charges in our room and cling together to become a dust bunnies. So these particles as well, they become a cosmic dust bunnies. As a matter of fact, they can grow quite large, and they do so by just undergoing very gentle and collisions which allows them grow to into rocks, then into boulders. Anything harder or fast would break these things apart, and as these things grow, they can withstand harder and stronger collision until they grow into the plant small. Planet small size at about 1 kilometer. They are massive enough to extract a gravitational pull on one another. This means that they can withstand higher collision, and in fact we see leftover planet small around the solar system today. They are more than the asteroids and comets and Kuiper belt objects. These planet smalls collide in a kind of proto solar system demolition derby. Most of these are destroyed and are later accreted onto the other planet small. And most massive of these planet small survive and now protoplanets. They began to clear out their objects, and you can even do a small and simple computer simulation like we have here. You can easily see how as objects collide into one another, and there are fewer and fewer these objects remaining. So when we look in systems like we can actually see those rings, and we can actually see those lanes are being curved out by protoplanets within the disks. So returning our attention to the gas giant, remember they too are forming out of the little disks. Within the disks, remember they are gonna form well beyond the frost line, where there is a high abundance of both refractory elements and volatiles. So they have everything. They gain mass by just collide with their own right. They are able to accrete these volatiles. Remember they are the farther from protostar, so there's a less heat, there's a less stellar wind, there's a greater abundance of these volatiles to begin with. Evolve from inside the protoplanet on accretion disks. This allows these massive outer solar system protoplanets to grow what were called their primary atmospheres. Primary atmosphere means that atmosphere of Jupiter and Saturn, for example, are the same atmosphere that they pretty much formed with. However, in the inner solar system, where we have lower mass protoplanets, it's much different. They are unable to hold on to these primary atmospheres. This atmosphere, remember the temperature much warmer near the protostar, or in this case the protosun. Hot gases are going to always move faster than cold gases. So if you have low mass planet with low mass gases, they can easily achieve escape velocity from those gases. Remember, the hotter they are, the faster they are going to be moving. They are also closer to the protosun. That means there are stronger stellar wind coming from the protosun, which just make it that much harder for lightweight volatiles to stick to the protoplanets. So any protoplanetary atmosphere of inner solar system is just going blown away by the sun. However, there's a lot smaller objects floating around the solar system and even outer solar system, and when we little tiny planet smell from our outer solar system falls towards the proto earth, they deliver these volatiles, and they are already volcanism on the planet. So we now get the formation of a secondary atmosphere. So about 4.5 billion years ago, the hot earth was really just one giant volcano. That entire surface was covered in volcanism, and whatever trace volatile materials the earth did formed with were quickly being released through volcanism. Comets and asteroids would deliver additional volatiles from outer solar system. So our atmosphere that we see and live under today is a secondary atmosphere, the 2.0 version of Earth's atmosphere. To put the whole thing into perspective, we can imagine the rotating disks, and we can envision tiny clumps of materials forming inside the disks. Those clumps would then go on to become the planets small, and even the protoplanets. Protoplanets would then have the ability to start sweeping out their orbits as the sun was undergoing its final fitful phases of its own formation. Protoplanets began to scoop up and sweep up orbits, thus clearing their paths and giving us solar system we live in today. That's all. Thank you.